Good morning, and the Lord be with you. Amen. Today in our worship celebration, there are several items that I hope will take place, and I just want to draw our attention to this at this time. First and foremost, in our midst this morning, Gerald Glenn Zimmerman, right here, known affectionately to us as Jerry, will be baptized in the Christian faith today. So will you join me in advance in giving thanks to the Lord for this? He is 92 years young, is that correct?
Not quite.
Not quite, but close enough to be 92 years old. So I draw this to our attention this morning, and that will take place right away and immediately following worship celebration this morning, in honor of the Lord's work among us, but in Jerry's life. There is cake and coffee and tea and anything else downstairs? More goodies. So please don't run away. Lord willing, will be done close to 10:30, somewhere between 10:30 and quarter to 11. Another announcement I want to say before we begin, so that, because Daryl, when you give announcements, I do want to highlight this one. Today is July the 12th, and in 2 months from now, August, September, on this day, September the 12th, actually the 11th, Grace Lutheran will be celebrating its 50th anniversary in this building. Don, you were on that building committee. You're the only living person here still on that committee, according to the church record. You know, it says here, chairman was Elmer Schmidt. Secretary was Mr. Swarren. Treasurer was Elmer Schelke. Elders were John Fetzner, Dan Schelke, and Elmer Schmidt. They're not here, are they? The only person still around is a guy named Mr. Don Birchie, financial secretary. So on What I want to know is this, and I know we're not everyone in the parish, but would we be willing to have on the Friday night, September the 11th, a supper in honor of our ancestors who built this building? And we would invite the priest of St. Francis Xavier, because we bought the church from the Roman Catholics. We would then invite the pastor at Bethel Lutheran, because they bought it from us. And Father Greg Farna, we would invite because he's the now priest of the Ukrainian Catholic Church, which is down there. But I am willing to work with this idea and to develop it. If there are people here this morning, it would just be a potluck supper, get together, and then we would have a service of celebration using the 1955 order of service and acknowledging, such as you, Don, the people who put time and effort to build our building. And second, on that night, if you can keep your treasures together right now, but on that night we would take an extra mile offering, and the money would go toward the property committee specifically for a new roof, because that's coming up. We have to put a new roof in. So you have all morning to think about this, and then at the end of the service, I'm going to ask us again, and then just say yes or no about the idea, okay? It's just the idea. And if you're willing to help me, then come on afterwards, okay? Finally, within our order of service today, baptism first, acknowledging the anniversary. Third is we're having the installation of our council officers, especially the new treasurer, Daryl. Welcome aboard, being on tap with us. Would you give thanks to the Lord for Daryl and his willingness to serve our Lord? Now that was really good. Now really give one for his wife, Marge, for Thanks, and welcome home, okay? We'll have a moment of silence, and then I'll invite us to stand, and we'll begin our worship celebration of our Lord who's here. Come, Holy Spirit, come for Jesus' sake. Amen. Congregation, please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart to God and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgive me my
sins. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. And now may the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We join together in singing our opening hymn, Blessed Jesus, at your word.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Together let us pray the prayer for this Sunday. O Lord, you granted your prophets strength to resist the temptations of the devil and courage to proclaim repentance. Give us pure hearts and minds to follow your Son faithfully, even into suffering and death, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings, and after the second reading, which is from Ephesians, we will celebrate the sacrament of baptism, and that's found on page 268 in the front of your book. So I ask you to turn to that now, page 268, in just a moment. The first reading is from Amos chapter 7, beginning at verse 7.
This is what he showed me. Behold, the Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, behold, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass by them. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent to Jeroboam, king of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the midst of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words. For thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from this land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go flee away to the land of Judah, and eat bread there, and prophesy there, but never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary, and it is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered and said to Amaziah, I was no prophet nor a prophet's son, but I was a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore figs. But the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, go prophesy to my people Israel. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And our second reading is from Ephesians chapter 1, beginning at verse 3.
Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glory, grace, with which he has blessed us with the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he has lavished upon us, in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he has set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to ignite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we obtained an inheritance, having predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to praise of his glory. In him we also, when you heard the word of the truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believe in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thanks, Ken and Leanne. Warm day, isn't it? I just find myself, hot days like this, muggy days like this, I wilt like a flower. You know, my flowers yesterday were needing water, and that's what's needed. And in the same way, A congregation, as it ages, must continually, gently ask Jesus to let the Spirit come and rain upon us, you know, like R-A-I-N, so that our faith life never gets withered. You know, when you get older, physically and spiritually, it's not lack of faith that hurts us. Most often is that we just get dry in our faith. You know, we become like plants that wither. I have to say that here at Grace, we've had, over the past year, four individuals, who I thought would, just like, wow. Like, starting with John Hamilton, and I'm going to end with you, Jerry. John Hamilton, you know, talking, visiting, are you baptized? And John said, I was surprised, you know, like, I thought being an old dude, it would already have been, but it wasn't, you know, an old flower renewing itself. And then, Leanne, are you baptized? I think so, but, you know, all of a sudden, another older flower, a little more prettier than John, just, you know, experiencing new life in Christ amongst a bunch of Christians who generally are used to seeing babies being baptized. And then, Ken Ma's dad, 83 years old? 86 years old. Sing. Would you like to be a Christian? Yes. Do you want to be baptized? Yes. Imagine, he could have finished his life. No one would have known. But in obedience to his Lord, he wants to experience this new life, this gentle rain. Grace, are you catching this? It's just not little babies that need to be renewed. Seniors need to be renewed. Which brings me to Jerry. You know, I came to Jerry, you know, because I'm visiting a second time round parishioners using a survey and asking one of the questions is, are you baptized? And when I asked Jerry that question directly, it was like, I don't know. I think I am. I'm not sure. And he inquired from his family and his parish, you know, the Daysland United Church. There was no conclusive evidence that this had taken place or didn't take place. He just wasn't sure. So I asked him, Jerry, would you like to be baptized? And he said, Jerry, do you want to be baptized today? Yes, you know. He could have, you know, ended, gone throughout all his life, and we would have none the worse, right? Again, I'm wanting to emphasize that here at Grace, there is just a gentle anointing, a gentle rain of the Spirit at this moment in history. It's not a torrent. It's not a downpour, you know, like Pine Lake and Red Deer area. There isn't a tornado going on in here. It is a gentle mist, just getting our leaves renewed and refreshed, but it causes growth. So on page 268 in the front of your worship book is the order for the sacrament of baptism. I draw this to our attention, and I'm going to ask, see, John, Ken Ma, will you come here? And would you grab just that end? And we're going to lift it up and just bring it a bit closer to Jerry on three. One, two, three. Is that close enough, Jerry? Yeah. Okay. By the way, happy birthday. In the Gospel of St. Matthew, Jesus says, all authority is in heaven and in earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And in the last chapter of St. Mark, our Lord promises that whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, and the Apostle Peter has written, "Baptism now saves you." This is what the Word of God teaches, that we are conceived and born in sin and are under the power of the devil until Christ claims us as his own. We would be lost forever unless delivered from sin, death, and everlasting condemnation. But the Father of all mercy and all grace has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, who atoned for the sin of the whole world, so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So Gerald Glenn Zimmerman, you are marked with the cross of Christ. For Jesus' sake, you are God's son. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we thank you for creating and giving to us to know, as a brother in Christ, as a fellow pilgrim in this earth, our brother Gerald Glenn, Jerry. We thank you that you will give to him a renewing of thy Holy Spirit through the work of your Son Jesus, who is present in this holy sacrament. Continue to let him know that for Jesus' sake, all his sins are atoned, and that for Jesus' sake, your mercy and your love will be with him now and forevermore until you call him home to eternal glory. For we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. I asked Jerry, when I saw him on Monday, who do you want to be as your godparents, you know? And he, without a hesitation, said, I would like the congregation to be my sponsors. And I said, well, I'm going to have to ask them because I don't have permission. You know, I don't. So I have to ask you guys a very serious question. Are you ready? Will you, as brothers and sisters in Christ, will you support Jerry in his walk with Jesus? Will you encourage him by the words that you speak to him? Will you support him by the actions that you will show through your hands? And will you this day, until the Lord calls him home to glory, walk with him as a Christian brother here within the church community called Grace Lutheran Church? If this is your desire, so answer, we do with the help of Jesus.
We do with the help of Jesus.
Well, that answers your question, Jerry. The congregation will be your sponsor. Jerry, I'm going to ask you a few questions, and then I'm going to ask the congregation a question or two. I'm on page 270. Gerald Glenn, do you renounce the devil? If so, answer, yes, I renounce him.
Yes, I renounce him.
Do you renounce all his works? So answer, yes, I renounce them.
I renounce them.
Do you renounce all the devil's ways? So answer, yes, I renounce them. Do you, brothers and sisters in Christ here at Grace, do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth? So answer, yes, I believe.
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. So answer, yes, I believe.
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting? So answer, yes, I believe.
Yes, I believe.
So again, I'm going to ask you one more time, Jerry. Do you desire to be baptized in the Christian faith this day? So answer, yes, I do. I sure wish we had a full submersion font. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Ken, come on over here. I'm going to ask you to help me one more time. I want you to hold the baptismal, what do you call that, bowl? Yeah. So, Gerald, I've got my towel here. Just come closer, Ken. That's right. Gerald Glenn Zimmerman, you are baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Oh, sorry, Jerry. Oh.
Okay, Ken. Oh, here, you dry yourself off. You okay? Oh, yeah. It's a ministry and a custom that I have embraced as a pastor, messenger of our Lord, to take opportunity of a meaning of name. And I hope today, when I talk to you about Gerald Glenn, that you will go, oh, wow, again, it makes sense. So the first of all, the name Gerald, it's an old German word. You know, Jerry, you know, Gerard, it, you know, those kinds of names come from it. And it just simply says the one who rules with the spear. You know, a sense of not being a tyrant, but a person who is confident and able to manage people around him. And that's, you know, in a good way, the Lord has given to you, he said to you, I am the one who is your warrior. I have disarmed the powers. And in me, Jerry, you will see me ruling your life with a spear. No evil will befall you. Colossians 1:15, Jesus has disarmed the powers that seek to hurt a person. You see that in Jerry, this life of Christ. But it's more the name Glenn that I have found most meaningful as I've gotten to know you, Jerry, as a person and as a pastor. It's from Ireland, Glen. It just means someone who lives from the valley. But in Ireland, when you come from the valley, it describes a kind of temperament. And I did a little work in this, and it says this. The person who has the name Glen usually tends to be someone who's considerate. Someone who's cooperative, someone who's quiet and reserved, sympathetic, and generally balanced in life. And I thought, my goodness, that's a good description of you, Jerry, from what I know about you. It says that they are trustworthy. You can commit your life to them. And finally, it said, they generally don't like change. That's true for Jerry, you know. He can adapt, but his preferences keep things the same. Jerry, within your life, there is a quiet disposition, a gentleness. This is who Jesus is in you. And because of that, people will come and feel safe and talk with you. This is a ministry. Even at 92, it's a great ministry because people will ask you, well, what does it all mean? And simply you will say to people, all this I know to be true is that Jesus loves me. This I know. Will you please welcome into our midst our brother, Gerald Jerry Glenn Zimmerman. Chris, on behalf of the worship committee, there is a candle up there. Will you please light it? And while you're doing that, again, I'm on page 271. While Chris is doing that, I'm going to do this. Receive, Jerry, the holy oil, anointing given by Jesus that reminds you that He has poured out the Holy Spirit upon you and within you, and that you have received the fullness of this Spirit in His life. And continue, Holy Spirit, to touch the heart of Jerry so that his love for you will continue to grow each and every day. Amen. Okay. So, Chris, on behalf of the worship committee, I'll take that from you. And on page 271, the P part, okay? Nice and loud.
Receive this burning light to show that you have received Christ, who is the light of the world. Live always in the light of Christ and be ever watchful for his coming, that you may meet him with joy and enter with him into the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which will have no end.
In holy baptism, God the Father has made you, Gerald Glenn, a member of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and an heir with us in all the treasures of heaven in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We receive you in Jesus' name as our brother in Christ, that together we might hear his word, receive his gifts, and proclaim the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. And together we say, Amen. We welcome you in the name of our Lord. Peace to the Lord, Jerry and Chris, on behalf of the church. Again, one more, give thanks to the Lord. Yeah, you can blow it, you can go. So Ken, if you'll come and help me again. We're going to sing the song, Jesus Loves Me. And as I'm moving the baptismal font, Dave, if you'll put the words up, together we sing this song. Please stand on three, Ken. One, two, three. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. The gospel reading for this Sunday is taken from St. Mark, the 6th chapter, beginning at verse 14. Herod Antipas, the king, soon heard about Jesus because everyone was talking about him. Some were saying, "This must be John the Baptist raised from the dead. That is why he can do such miracles." Others were saying, "He's the prophet Elijah." And still others were saying, "He is a prophet like the other great prophets of the past." When Herod heard about Jesus, he said, "John, the man I beheaded, has come back from the dead." For Herod had sent soldiers to arrest and imprison John as a favor to Herodias. She had been his brother Philip's wife, but Herod had married her. And John had been telling Herod, "It is against God's law for you to marry your brother's wife." So Herodias bore a grudge against John and wanted to kill him. But without Herod's approval, she was powerless. For Herod respected John, and knowing that he was a good and holy man, he protected him. Herod was greatly disturbed whenever he talked with John, but even so, he liked to listen to him. Herodias' chance finally came on Herod's birthday. He gave a party for his high government officials, army officers, and the leading citizens of Galilee. Then his daughter, also named Herodias, came in and performed a dance that greatly pleased Herod and his guests. Ask me for anything you like, the king said to the girl, and I will give it to you. He even vowed, I will give whatever you ask up to half my kingdom. She went out and then asked her mom, what should I ask for? And her mom told her, ask for the head of John the Baptist. So the girl hurried back to the king and told him, I want the head of John the Baptist right now and on a tray. Then the king deeply regretted what he had said. But because of the vows he had made in front of his guests, he couldn't refuse her. So he immediately sent an executioner to the prison to cut off John's head and bring it to him. The soldier beheaded John in the prison, brought his head on a tray, and gave it to the girl, who then took it to her mom. When John's disciples heard what happened, they came to get his body and buried it in a tomb. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. This is one of those Sundays where I'm glad I'm not preaching on the gospel lesson. Welcome to Grace Lutheran and the story of the beheading of John the Baptist. It's one of those stories that betrays and belies the joy of the Lord, you know, in our midst. But it is a story nonetheless, and just reminds us, please, it reminds us that pray for our government. You know, pray for whatever political party is in place in, you know, in Alberta and in Canada. You know, we need godly men and women to lead and guide us, because it can quickly go amok. So, gracious Father, we come in Jesus' name to you this morning. We thank you for your goodness in our life, just for being good. And we pray that it is this goodness that stirs our heart and our life in continually walking with your Son, Jesus. For I ask this in his name. Amen. So in after the sermon, just before the Holy Communion, we're going to hear the psalm that's appointed for today. It's Psalm 85, particularly verse 12. And Dave's got that on the screen. I hope you can read it. If you can't, it just simply says, indeed the Lord will give what is good, so that our land will yield its abundant produce. Verse 12. On Tuesdays of each week, I leave Camrose and I drive to my cousin, whose name is Dean. He lives in the county of Strathcona on the east end, you know, out toward the county of Beaver. And Dean is a farmer. He's a mixed farmer. He raises cattle. He grows hay with a few grain fields. I've been doing this since I've arrived back from Ottawa in 2007. And I needed to do this because after being in the ELCIC, but more so in a urban setting of a, in Lutheranism, we'll call it a mid-sized Lutheran church, I really needed time away from people. I'll tell you right up front that I enjoy pastoring. I do enjoy visiting with you. But, you know, being amongst people is also hard on my soul. The sorrows, the griefs, the joys, the yin, the yangs, was like someone taking a sponge and, or I feel like a sponge and squeezing me, or like a straw and, you know, sucking all my energy out. So I needed to get away. I need to leave, and oftentimes you will not find me here in Camrose. But while going to my cousin's house, I've rediscovered an important biblical truth that slowly I had forgotten during my time in urban settings. What I discovered while walking with my cousin and working with my cousin on a farm, you know, hauling hay, working with cattle, you know, getting my hands dirty with the soil, I have rediscovered that nothing in life can exist without the gracious will of our Heavenly Father. Catch that? There's nothing in this life, not a single moment of any creature that lives on this planet can exist without the Lord who gives that creature life. And I say this, I mean, it may seem so obvious, but I say this because many a person who lives in the city, who lives in the village, or who lives in big cities, forgets that they are creatures created by God and sustained in their life by the gracious heart of the Father. I mean, there are people today who think that milk comes from Saputa. You know, where does milk come from? You go to Safeway or Superstore or wherever, and milk you buy in the carton. That's where milk comes from. There are people who honestly believe that oil comes from Petrocan or Mobil or Suncor, and they forget that the oil is the result of living, breathing creatures that have died and lie within the very planet that we live on. There are people who believe that our homes that we built are built by contractors, independent ones, or Gary Zetson or whoever, or Rona and Home Hardware. And they fail to see that that wood that is supplied, well, that was a tree at one time, a living, breathing species like you and I. I mean, forgotten in North America in the 21st and the 22nd century is this reality by many a person that our life exists because of a gracious, loving, creating God in our life. You know, we have moved far, far away from being creatures dependent on this Lord who takes care of creation to actually believing that we can take care of ourselves, that we somehow have the ability to live long and prosperous because something I have done makes it so. That is not a biblical belief. That is not the message that Psalm 85 brings to God's people who hears this word today. Psalm 85, but particularly verse 12, yes, the Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. This is the word that we hold onto today with vim and vigor as brothers and sisters in the Lord. Indeed, it is the Lord who is good. And because the Lord is good, he will give to us what is good, so that what is given to us will produce good things in our life. I mean, three times in this verse, although the English doesn't catch it, three times the word good is used. You know? First, the Lord is good. It describes the very character of who our Creator is. Imagine, in the God that we worship this morning, there is no intent to hurt us. There is no intent to be evil against us. There is no intent to cause us any kind of suffering. The Lord who is good, his character is of love and compassion and of mercy and tenderness to all that he has made in this creation. So even to think, to entertain the thought that anything malicious, anything hurtful, anything that in any way causes your heart or your life to feel suffering and pain in some manner that would emerge from God, is the farthest thing that Scripture reveals to us. How can I say it, or how can the Lord say it any clearer? He loves you, and He never wants anything to hurt or harm you. That's His character. That's His nature. That's how He wants to relate to us. Second, this good Lord then uses building blocks which are good. My son comes over to our house. His name is Philip. And years ago, Philip said, "Dad, I want to be a carpenter." And he's working toward that. I didn't realize how long and hard that could be. And then I said to him, "Philip, well, let me help you out. Let Mom and I help you out by buying you some tools." And now, please note, I'm not a carpenter. Got it? I don't know what are good tools or what are not good tools. And then he said, now, this is his choice, "Oh, Dad, if you could buy DeWalt equipment, that's really good equipment." And so we bought that. You know, we bought this kind of equipment because we are convinced by our son that this is good equipment. Good meaning it's safe, it's sound, it does its job. We switched from a DeWalt table saw, we bought a Bosch table saw, you know, and various kinds. Wanting to give Philip good, safe tools. Because with good tools, the worker gets the job done right. The Lord uses good building blocks to get His job done right. From dust He made who? Please raise your hand. Who did He make? Me. I mean, He could have used anything else, but He knew that the earth of this soil is good. It produces life. You know, the Lord uses other building blocks to get the job done in creation. And when it was done, what did He finally say, or what was said when it was finally done? And the Lord saw what He had made, and it was good. You know, no mistakes. You know, I used faulty products and I got a faulty, you know, product, you know. The Lord who is good makes good stuff. And finally, from this verse, it will produce a good crop. It will yield its increase. When God makes, God makes it to thrive, not die. The other day, Gertie, this is to follow up. The other day, I took this big plant and I transplanted it. You know, I dug it in the soil, and I know it was hot out, and I'm not a gardener, so some of you may who are really gardeners will go, oh, you know. I dug it out and I put it back in the soil. In about 2 hours later, guess what the flower looked like? I thought I killed it. I really did. I mean, I was sad. And so I saw Gertie and Dave last night, remember? And I said, "Oh, Gertie, you know, Gertie," because she's, you know, she's just got green, show your thumbs, Gertie. She's got green thumbs, you know. And I said, "Oh, I think I killed this plant." And it's this, I mean, it's a big, beautiful plant. And she said, "Oh, don't worry, Pastor, it'll come back. You know, it'll come back." And I said, "Are you sure, Gertie?" And she looked at me, you know, with her smile, "It'll come back, Pastor." Guess what? This morning, it looks great, you know. I had watered it, I had planted it. The soil will produce. I'm drawing this out because this is what I discovered when I'm with my cousin Dean on the farm. You know, when you live in a city, you sort of forget all that, I believe. You forget, you know, especially if you don't have a garden or if you don't have a flower bed, if you only buy produce from, you know, the stores, you forget how good God is in providing for us, creatures of this earth. Where am I going with this? I'm going to leave, Dave. I'm going this way. I just want to draw our attention to the good work that Jesus is doing here within Grace Community. Jesus is good. He is kind. He is merciful. He never wants anyone here in this congregation to experience, you know, any evil toward one another. It's just juxtaposed to who he is. You know, if there has been pain, we caused it, not our Lord. We are the ones that hurt each other, not Jesus who relates to you. And our desire, or our Lord's desire, who is good, is that we experience his goodness in our life. And if you're Jerry, well, he's going to be 92 years old, you know. Or the other day, you know, Suzanne was holding the little baby, you know, just months old. Young or old, here within Grace Community, the goal of God who is present is for us to experience his goodness, his mercy, his kindness. And to do that, he uses building blocks. Example. One of them is right here. The sacrament of holy baptism. In these waters, we experience Jesus who comes, Jerry, and this morning has publicly hugged you and says, he loves you. I believe that to be true. This isn't just a ritual, just a rite. This is one way that you really know that Jesus loves you. That's why Luther would always say, I'm baptized. It wasn't that he was trying to be super ritual. He knew a concrete day when Jesus literally hugged him and held him close to his heart. And he lived in that moment ever since then. That's one place, one building block. Another one is right here at Holy Communion. I cannot stress over and over and over again that it is Jesus who is present here. He is present in this meal, offering his mercy to those who believe that he gives that mercy to them. That's why he invites you to come, to receive. And in faith, you know that the Lord is merciful to you. And why do you need mercy? Why is Jesus offering mercy? Because he knows how unmerciful we can be. Not just to another person, but oftentimes we are the hardest on ourselves. And what's the end result? Here in this community, Jesus, who is good, using good building blocks to build his community, will cause in your heart the love of the Father abundantly, so that when times in your life are going well, or when times in your life are really being strained, instead of giving up, you literally have the strength to keep going with the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. That's the abundant life. That's what it's all about. So that we can then share with each other honestly, honestly, Jesus, who then gives us his life one to another. That's what the psalmist is wanting to communicate to people then, and that is the message that our Lord today wants to talk to us about. Trust in him. He is good. He uses good building blocks to make us enjoy his good work in and among us today and forever. Amen. At this time in our celebration, we will receive the offering. Congregation, please stand. Oh, no, not stand. Be seated. We're going to ushers come forward. Tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Could he give? Oh, how he loves me. Gracious Father, we thank you for this day and your mercy and your kindness and goodness to us and to all that you have made seen and unseen. We pray, Lord, that the stirring of the Spirit would make us always to be thankful to you for your mercy and kindness and never to presume upon that. For we pray this in your name. Amen. Before we enter into the prayer of the church, Psalm 85, Dave, is that up on the board there? And together we will recite Psalm 85. Please remain seated. Together. Surely his salvation will those who are council members please come forward to the front of the altar, and the elders who are present please come and stand behind them. During the past few months, we have called and elected people to serve as officials here as council members at Grace Lutheran. Otto Saleen is our council chair. At this present time, we have a vacancy, and we're just waiting for the Lord to call that person as council secretary. Daryl Seib, you are the council treasurer, and you are also a new person on this council. Evangelism is Dave Goss returning. Property is John Hamilton. Lori Blades, who I know is going to be away, worship, and Renee Quinlan is in Tuscany, Italy right now, She and her husband are celebrating their 25th wedding anniversary on a cruise in and around that area. Otto, have I missed any person for counsel? One, two. Oh! Joe Ma is head of the elders, but he is represented on council by Pat Quinlan. So this is the council that we have called and elected to help us discern the Lord's leading. So Otto and John, if you'll come a little closer, and Wilf, if you just stand back there. So Daryl, you're going to be part of this. You know, I'm not going to segregate you or anything like that, just a part, okay? The following people have been called and elected to positions of leadership. I've asked them to come forward. St. Paul writes, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit gives them. There are different ways of serving, but the same Lord is served. There are different abilities to perform service, but the same God gives to everyone ability for particular service. The Spirit's presence is shown in some way in each person for the good of all. So Daryl and Otto and John and Dave and Lori and Renee and Pat, you have been elected to positions of leadership and trust in this congregation. So I ask you the following questions, and then at the end, so answer yes with the help of God. Will you see that the words and the deeds of this household of faith reflect Jesus in whose name we gather? Will you see to it that we work together with other members so that we may worship together and work for Jesus, and the work that we do will be God's will done for the benefit and the goodness of this community? Will you be diligent in your area of service, knowing that it is the Lord and His Spirit that empowers you in that service? And finally, will you continue to be an example of Christian faith, active in love, to help maintain the life and the harmony of Christ in this community? If this is your desire, so answer, we do with the help of our Lord.
We do with the help of our Lord.
If you'll please turn and face the congregation. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I ask you, will you support these, your elected leaders, and will you share in the mutual ministry that Jesus has given to us, all who are baptized? If this is our desire, so answer yes with the help of God.
Yes.
So just turn and face this way. And Wilf, if you'll raise your hand like this and quietly, I'm just going to pray. Gracious Father, for Jesus' sake, continue to let Jesus do an anointing of thy Spirit upon each of the council members so that they will have his wisdom and his courage and his heart and mind to know your leading, Lord. And for your sake, let Grace Community enjoy the Christian fellowship that you alone create here. For we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Wilf, if you share the peace, Lord. Peace to the Lord. Peace to the Lord. Peace, Lord. Peace, Lord Daryl. Okay. Please return back to your seats. At this time in our celebration, we'll enter into the celebration for Holy Communion. Will you please stand? Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do for the remembrance of me." In the same way, also Jesus took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me." Together we pray thee, our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses.
As we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Amen. Please remain standing as we sing Holy, Holy, Holy. Communion assistant, please come forward.
Thank you.
Gracious Father, we come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus, for we can never enter into your presence in and of ourselves. But your Son lives within us. By faith we believe that he has come in sermon and baptism and Holy Communion, come to abide and to dwell in our lives, and to hear him say that he is merciful and kind and good to us. We thank you, Holy Father, that in Jesus' name we can bring friends, brothers, and sisters before us who need your healing grace in their life, Lord. We think of Elsie and Milda and Ida and Arthur, Richard and Francis and Tom, Alice and Ella, Cheryl and Barry, Bunny and Isabel. We thank you for safe return of Shane from the Northwest Territories, for Dennis and his healing grace, for Bruce and your healing grace, along with Brenda and also with Bernice. Let your blessing rest upon Rosemary this week as she celebrates your Holy Communion in her life. And Father, there are many other items and events, relationships that we just bring before you silently at this time. And just ask that your presence would lead and guide, would bring blessing and direction where needed, correction and rebuke, so that you, Jesus, who have begun a good work in us, will bring it to completion until the day you call us home to glory or upon your return. For we ask this in your name. Amen. And now may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us now and forevermore. Amen. Parish announcements.
Good morning, all my brothers and sisters in Christ.
Good morning, Daryl.
Prayer is important. Prayer can sustain this church, heal the sick, and reach out to the lost. Prayer is something everyone can do. Join Landy, Donna, and others as they pray for the church and the world, Wednesdays at 6 o'clock p.m. VBS, Camp Discovery, August 10th to the 14th. Tell your friends, neighbors, children, and grandchildren. Pat and Renee Quinlan invite the congregation of Grace Lutheran to the wedding of Josh Quinlan and Ataza Anastasia
Onanides.
August 8th. Please RSVP to Pat or Renee if you wish to attend. Movie night, Faith Like Potatoes, the true story of Angus Buchan, South African farmer turned evangelist. Senior VBS at Wednesdays at Viewpoint, July 1st to July 29th. Healing prayer service for those who are troubled or sick. The Bible advises us to seek prayer and anointing when we need healing. Come and receive the healing power of the Holy Spirit in your life. Elders meeting July 16th. The Weebs will be performing here this Friday, July 17th at 7 o'clock p.m. Come yourselves, invite your friends, the husband and wife worth hearing. Join us for edifying evening of song. Has anybody else got any announcements? Yes, Ken.
Okay, that's good. Come, Ken. Veronica, in just a moment, you'll be coming forward, okay? So don't think I've forgotten you or we've forgotten you, okay? Go ahead, Ken, not too long.
Okay. Be aware that the healing ministry is on the move and things are happening. The grace of God is healing people. Okay? So we, no matter how small it is, whatever ache and pain or anything more serious, please come on down and see how our Lord Jesus Christ is helping. Okay?
So, amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Veronica was a congregational representative to the district convention in May. She's going to come forward and give a brief, a personal experience. Her official report will be given at a congregational meeting in either September or October. Veronica, please, as you come forward, I'm just going to highlight, just come forward, please. I'm going to make us aware of where our district is in regards to the CEF fund and so forth. So as of this moment, July the 12th, the plans for somewhat recovery of the investors, depositors of the CEF is before the lawyers and before the committees. For those in DIL, such as myself, it looks as if we will lose at least 25 or more cents on the dollar. For those in the CEF, the recovery is far greater. It can be up to 50 to 60 cents in the dollar that will be lost. There is right now a lot of legal battles going on. You as congregation are not paying for these battles. The money is coming from the investors whose money has been gone and stolen, systematically victimized by, you know, and it was our district officers, starting from Don Sheeman down to the Board of Officers. They were the ones who are culpable and will, Lord willing, be held culpable at a later date in a court of law. Veronica?
Good morning.
Morning.
So I attended from May 22nd to the 24th, and
it's okay, Veronica. Go ahead.
There were 158 delegates that also attended. So the delegates were clergy, lay people, advisory clergy, and advisory deacons. So there were three new deacons brought into the church. There were 14 new pastors that came into the district. And there were four congregations that redid their constitution, and it was accepted at the convention. There was two things that I thought were very important. One was that the district has looked forward in how they're managing things, and they've decided to sort of split the duties for now between two focus kind of ministries. One is that the district president, who was elected at convention, he's to focus on all the financial and the business matters at hand, which is convening a lot of meetings with the monitor and the chief restructuring officer. You've probably heard those names before, but the majority of his work will be focused on that. He will be doing ministerial work, but he will be, I guess the term could be seconded to all that business because of the court proceedings. The other focus is on the spiritual guide of our district, and they term that called ecclesiastical business. So that of the Spirit. And in order to help out our ABC district, at convention the first evening, they elected by majority motion to have a representative from the national office in Winnipeg to help out with the healing process and the hearing people's concerns, visiting congregations, and renewing the church through a forgiveness and a refreshing of the ministry. They also wanted to refocus the ministry of our ABC district to missions, so taking care of ourselves, other people in our districts, our circuits, and also looking forward and outward to overseas. And one of the motions that was passed was to have congregations look at sponsoring refugees. And right now, the Lutheran World Relief has a statistic of about 51.2 million refugees. And just to give you a reference, that's more than what we had at the end of World War II. So there are that many refugees without in the world that are looking for homes, places to stay, to sustain their families and that kind of thing. So for our district, they've asked congregations to look at ways in which we can support those efforts of Canada World Relief and our government. So they've asked that if we could write letters, speak to our government officials, if we are so inclined to sponsor a family. And there, I have some details about how that sponsorship can go. According to the Canadian Lutheran World Relief, our congregations in Canada, the Lutheran congregations, are very well respected in bringing over immigrant families and sponsoring people that are refugees. We're well respected, and the success of people that are refugees that we have sponsored in our congregations across Canada, all of those people have been very successful at becoming Canadian citizens and becoming contributing members in Canada. So we garner quite a bit of respect in that fashion. And that was very, very, very pleasing for me to hear when I was at convention. The second day of convention focused the morning proceedings. The majority of focused on the CEF and the DIL. And there are some very there's some very tough things that were said and tough things that have to happen. I'll get into detail later about those if anyone has questions in the report I'm giving later. The gist of it is that the people who were making decisions may have been aware for things for a long time. They may have made decisions from their heart that weren't wise. And a lot of the congregational delegates questioned whether there were things like conflict of interest, behavior unbecoming of our funds and that kind of thing. And I kind of summed it up this way. The givings and the donations that the members of the church body had given were not dealt with as completely or as thoughtfully as which they had been given. So in order to help that as well, the district appointed a third party, an independent third party body that is going to look at the last 20 to 25 years of what went on in the district to answer the majority of the people's questions on things like, when did we first know? When did things happen? What happened? How were the decisions made to that we've come to this spot? The district and these are four different individuals that I know that I've heard. They are, one is a psychologist, two are senior financial members from institutions in Canada. One is a retired bank officer, and I can't remember what bank he's from, but the other two are more senior business type individuals, and they will be looking at all of the records regarding the matters of CEF, DIL, and the church to understand how the culture was and the decisions were made in that culture. Some of the congregational lay members that were there asked if they would receive an apology from the district for the actions, which is gospel, is according to Matthew, that if we have done wrong to our fellow parishioners, we're to ask forgiveness and then receive the blessing of forgiveness. At that point, a lawyer for the district who had been appointed by them as a legal representative stood up and said that if at convention there was to be asking for forgiveness or wanting to admit that they were sorry, that the lawyer said that it would deem them as being Guilty. And the lawyer was very aware that that there were a lot of people there looking forward to that and wanting to hear the strength of the faith in the forgiveness aspect. But he did say, he said that if you wanted to be angry at anyone for not saying they're sorry or not asking for forgiveness, that he was to blame and we should direct our messages to him. But I don't remember his name, so I don't know if you can get a hold of him. So, but I think the church is at a precipice of attendance. Our attendance has gone down. The givings from the congregations have lessened because there's a feeling of withholding the monies from district. But I think we can give, this most recently there's been a court decision that there was a hold on our givings to the district, that they would not send the 35% that we normally send off to national office. The court has decided that we can continue to take that of the givings of the church, and we can take our givings and give 35% to district. So that's changed since convention. And we're also encouraged to focus and work on missions within our immediate area. The other thing that the church wanted to know is that because there's a movement to change how our church does our business work. So the national at Alberta BC convention, they decided that we would change the way the politics of our church work, and they're looking at reforming that portion. They're looking at going forward so that things that if a pastor's teachings and skills are in ministry, that he's not required to have the skills in managing the business side. So they're looking at how can we have a good spiritual leader, but also how can we have the good political and financial directions that we need. So that came forward very strong, and they are again looking at making that a difference in the future. That's about it.
Now don't run away. Thank you, Veronica. There is a lot more to her report, both in general and detailed, that I want to emphasize. And together with council, we will have a evening session just for those who are interested here at the congregation. A couple things that have come out is that Veronica will be attending over the next 3 years till the next convention. She is the congregation's delegate to our Winkle circuit, where we will have what they call a circuit forum. Matters pertaining to the district, you know, in light of all this, will be held and discussed. So Veronica and I will be attending these, and it is open season, it's open game. We will not let the old system reemerge with a new face. Damage has been done. People have been sinned against, but most important, the work of doing Jesus' work has been hindered and harmed because of that. So in advance, thank you for that 3-year commitment, and she will keep us posted, and that's really good to hear. Second, this pastoral person, you will know him because he is Norman Ashley's. Hi, Norm. He's in Mexico right now, but he's Norman Ashley's cousin. Nolan Ashley has been appointed by the National Bishop to be the pastor who's going around listening. I have no idea how effective that will be, but just pray for him and so forth. Anything else? You've done a great job. Give thanks to the Lord. Her official report will be handed to council and be given for the congregational meeting, at which point then you will ask us to vote in favor of it. But there will be time, also another time, for a more detailed report for that, okay? Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Veronica. Gertie, are we all set for downstairs? Well, we're going to go downstairs and have a celebration for you, Gerald. So please, Jerry, if you can start making your way to go downstairs, We have a cake and coffee and everything for you, okay? And we'll give our greetings to you down there. So if you'll just go with Gertie, just wait for Gerald here, okay? So can you walk out with Gertie back there? Okay, you'll catch up to her. And also this week, we've, you know, just there are anniversaries that take place. There are birthdays like, you know, Albert, your birthday was this week, right? 88 years young. Yeah, so there are other birthdays. Please, Gerald's birthday's coming up. He'll be 92 years young. So remember each and every one at that time. Let's stand and sing, Sent Forth by God's Blessing. It's two verses long. His name that we bear. Go in peace, serve our risen Lord.